Right then, just like to thank everyone for coming. It's great at Cottam to put these on and show them out. So basically, I've set the day up this morning with cracks and blemishes, which was a funny kind of subject for me. But how it come about is I was down at the Royal Show, which was a month ago, and Jill came up to me, who works at Cottam, and says, "Do you want to see a picture of my crack?" And I thought, hell on a minute, yeah. So, and that's how it started. And I looked at the picture of her horse's feet, and she said, "When you do the open day, you brought the horse down, do you have a look and see what you think about it?" So that's how it started. So we're going to do just a little talk about my opinion on cracks and blemishes, and then we'll get the horse in and we'll do more practical, which is what I'd rather be doing on the horse. So we'll start off, I'll just load it up. I always like to have that picture on when I switch the computer on because it reminds me of when I used to have hair, so it's great. It sets you off on a good note. And it was only 3 years ago. So, let's put this on. So it's, when I first thought about this after the Royal Show, I thought, well, it's kind of hard because I'm in the same position as all you are. I've shod most of my horses I've been qualified for 8 years. I've shod all mainly the same horses for 8 years. So a lot of them don't really have any bad cracks because as the crack develops, you sort it out and it's sorted. But I've got some photos at the back, but I wish when I had a first set up and I took more photos, when you're at a yard and you see a bad crack and you staple it or you put a plate on and you fix it, I wish I had took photos of it, but you think, "Oh, I've got to go to the next yard," and you get in the van off you go. And then when you come to do something else, you think, "I wish I had took photos of it." But in my opinion, 99% of cracks, as long as the horse is shod, regular interval, everything's in the right place, his feet are dressed, there's no dishes, flares, and like I say, the owner's looking after it, his environment's right, his diet's good, 99% of them sort themselves out. And if we regularly shoe them, it's not a problem. And it's the other 1% that is the problem in the job. So I'll just start off with what are they? How I describe it is a hoof cracks occur in various positions in the horn of the wall, appearing to split and separate the tubular arrangement. The length and depth of the crack also varies, with most developing from the base as a result of stress, while some is caused by direct trauma or penetration of the coronary band. So when I say stress there, I think the majority of them are stress fractures. When the foot's gone long, the heels are under stone, the toe's long, the descending weight of the limb is sinking down on it, and the tubules have got to crack, they've got to separate. So I prefer the word stress fracture. Observation suggests that the term stress fracture is appropriate in the majority of cases, as most common type of fracture is the total quarters. These areas are subject to excessive pressures in the event of capsular distortion. So that's where the foot's got to give at the total quarters. So I've tried to keep it into simple form. I'd say they fall into three categories. You've got complete, which extends completely the length of the wall. Incomplete is less than the full height. And you've got complicated or deep, which involve the sensitive structures. Normally there's the bleeding and the lay, and that's the 1% where you've got to do something different. So every day we tend to put them in a bracket, we'll say, "Oh, it's got a toe crack, it's got a quarter crack," and that's every day understanding for a horse owner. And I think that's the level I would talk to a horse owner on. Yeah, it's got a bad toe crack, it's mobile, it's moving, or it's not, it's stable, and I'd work with that. But for today we've put, they're referred to by type, or nature, location and depth. So we've got our sand crack, which originates in the coronary band, continues distally running parallel to the horn tubule, either completely or partly towards the distal border, and they can be thought of as a fracture to the hoof wall. So it can be, you've got a sand crack, it can be complete or incomplete. Grass crack, which is more of what we deal with all the time, really, when your horses are turned out and you turn up to shoe it and they've just got little flares at the bottom, they've gone a little bit long between trimming. Originates at the distal border. Again, it runs parallel to the horn tubules, but proximally, it's either complete or partly towards the coronary band, and they can be thought of as a split in the hoof wall. And then we've got the horizontal crack, which to me, a horizontal crack is it's a direct trauma or it's a blow to the coronary. It's a damage to where the horn cells are produced. And to me, a horizontal crack, I don't get too excited about it, but I would tell a customer, I'd point out any cracks. As soon as I go and see a new horse, I'd point everything out, because the way that I see horseshoes developed in the short period I've been doing it is that they love you, but until they see there's a fault, then you're the biggest turnaround, so you get the blame for it. So, you know, anything now, you know, any confirmation defect, right? I don't go overboard, but if it's going to affect the shoeing, then I point it out straight away now, and I talk to them about it. So it's horizontal crack, it's parallel with the coronary band, initiates it at the coronary band and goes out with the hoof, causes a little problem. Obviously, the third root gets down, you've got the problem of it, of the piece coming off, so you've got a partial hoof wall missing, so with horses treading, nailing and stuff like that. But to be honest, if it's horizontal crack and it's two-thirds the way up, if anyone's been to a talk about me before, I like good strong nailing, I like them spread out. If I nail into horizontal crack, it doesn't bother me. If it's two-thirds the way up there, it's stronger than a nail a third below it, you know? So it doesn't bother me nailing into one of them. So location, as we said, mainly at the toe and the quarters, but you get them in the sole and the bars, especially these big old flat-footed horses where the toe's long, the heels are slung forward and there's excess weight bearing on the heels, then the bars will crack probably halfway down. You've got your sole cracks. They don't normally cause a problem, I wouldn't do anything about them. So then I go on to the deck. We've got the next kind of subheading. I'd say you've got superficial. It's the only penetrate the outer horn. Although if neglected, these can become deep or complicated. I think that's an important thing, because I've just said to you, 99% of cracks are, don't worry me, if the horse is shod properly, but a superficial crack, just a hairline crack, can turn into a deep or complicated crack if the owner lets it go too long, its feet are overgrown, it starts overgrowing the shoe, and that puts all the pressure on it. So then a deep or complicated is, like we said, penetrate the sensitive tissues. Limb mysterious up from the movement of the edges of the crack, causing like a pinching of the sensitive lamellae. So it's a bit of a picture I did the other night. See what she lost is now. It's just a picture to demonstrate the cracks. You've got the nature or the type, you've got your grass cracks, horizontal crack, and you've got a sand crack. The location of them, you've got your toe, you've got your heel, all the simple stuff, your bar and your sole. Horseshoe isn't rocket science, it's all pretty simple. And then there's a picture at the bottom, so it's not that clear, but it was just, this is your deep complicated crack, and that's your superficial one at the bottom. You can see the foot's taking a bit of a bell shape to it with the stress of that. This picture just shows you the tubular arrangement and your sensitive laminae, and that crack penetrates into your sensitive, and that's just a superficial. So there's a picture from when we were all at college, which seems quite a long time ago, the more I go on about it, but that's just showing you different type of cracks on there. You've got your sand cracker at the toe, and you've got some little fractures of the wall here, and that is, you know, just going to come off, and you've got a false quarter, and that's just showing where the foot's flared there, and that's where it should naturally be. So we'll move down, we'll do a little bit about false quarter. False quarter, a term used to describe the abnormal hoof wall growth from a severe coronary band lesion. So normally from an injury, a wire cut, and he's got the horse got his foot stuck in a gate. And the papillae, which is the nipple-like projection that produced the horn growth, that produced the horn tubules are damaged, and the horn grows in a disorganised, weakened manner, which it hasn't got a pattern of a normal horn tubule. The width, obviously, of this false quarter depends on the size of the original lesion. There's often a sand crack down the centre, which is true, you always see. There's always a sand crack down the middle, more superficial than anything else, it's not deep. And then I just put a sheared heel there. I didn't know which part to put that into the top really, because is a sheared heel really a hoof crack? Well, it is really, to me it is, and it's something that I think causes quite a lot of nervousness, and it certainly deals with quite a lot. The way I used to describe it is independent heel movement. So right up the back of your front, your central cleft, in between your heels, until you get independent heel movement. So the way I describe it is a term to describe failure of internal structures which normally bind the heels together. Allows the heels to move independently more than normal and can cause nervousness. It's always associated with thrush. Whether thrush comes first and then the sheared heel or sheared heel and thrush, I don't know the answer, but they're always together. I tend to treat sheared heels, I think, behind, not a great problem. Obviously, most of your weight bearings on your front limbs. I think in front, sheared heels are a problem. When you've got horses landing, medial lateral balance is a big thing. Try and get them to land. They land outside, or land heel first slightly, and then land outside, and then you've got a secondary land on the inside, and that's what obviously causes a lot of the sheared heel. But with all these cracks is to figure out what the cause is of that individual one. And how I deal with sheared heel is I normally put a straight bar on. I prefer straight bars, and you get a better heel fit. I think you cover the back further, the front more, stops the front falling through, keep shoes on, which we all want an easy life. And then I get them to treat it, normally iodine or some different, you can get white light, and there's hundreds of things on the market. But I think different, not that I want to go down the route of talking about thrush, but I think different, to clear the sheer deal, you've got to treat the thrush. But I think different bands of thrush react different to different remedies. So some will work great with iodine or purple spray, some will work great with white lightning. I don't think thrush is simply just thrush, there's different categories of it. And I think sometimes they get immune to different products and it doesn't work. I tend to make a sausage of cotton wool, put that in just in the back of the heel, not too tight, so you don't want pressure, and hold it open too much, but just holds open the lesion at the back of the heel, lets the air in for the anaerobic bacteria that we'll get back onto our cracks and causes. Yeah, there's loads of different causes, but as I put at the top there, I've just said recognition of the cause of the crack is fundamental. You can't fix a crack unless you know what's causing it. So there's a list I made. If it's not one on there, then I don't know the answer to it. So recognition of it is fundamental. So I've put there anterior, posterior, that's your foot balance, your front to your hand, medial lateral hoof or limb balances. And a lot of cracks are caused by, it's not just the foot you're looking at, it's caused by further up the limb and what the limb is. And some of them, you know, you can't fix it, you can't fix everything. If a horse has got a limb defect, it's got a limb defect, so it's going to land different, it's going to load different, that's going to cause a crack. So there's only so much you can do with every case. Neglect is a big one, like I said earlier. Any superficial crack, if it's left too long. And we all have customers. I have some. This horse, I go to this ride every 6 weeks. It's too short and it's free trim. So let's save a bit of money, do the trims every other time. Feet were great. Yeah, okay, if that's what you want to do. So every other time, the trims were 12 weeks. We all know it's too long. So you go back, it's got grass cracks and all 4 feet, then it's a massive job to get them back. So then I end up going once a fortnight, depriving all the crack out, taking the edges off, and she treats it, And then we're back to where we want to be, and that was all caused with one chewing of neglect and going too long. So obviously, excess hoof length, or maybe overgrown, and following the bell shape that we showed on the picture earlier. And that's quite a good comment, that until this week, I must admit, I completely forgot about that, and I got my books out when I did this. And it's a long time since I've got them out, since I did my associate. And the longer the wall grows, the drier and more brittle it becomes. And that's right, because all adjacent to the lamp on the bed, it's going to be comparatively more moist, you know, because it is closer. So I think that's a good point. When the feet are really, really long, that's obviously a big cause of it, as well as the horn is drier and brittle, especially with the environment that we live in, you know, when you've got horses in a stable out in the wood. And I think a lot of it's to do with, like, your hands when they get the wood on, and then when you let the wood dry on, that cracks your feet on. I think a lot of it with hoof cracks and poor quality feet, especially we're coming to the end of it now, to me, where, you know, that you go back and all the nails, it's all cracked up to there. I think a lot of it's to do with the pH level in the soils. I don't know about that. When I've done a clinic here before, I've spoke about that, and I've had horses in one pasture, and they've moved to a different pasture, and the feet have just gone to hell, and you think, oh, I'm not putting my shot for this woman for 3 years, because she's going to think I'm no good, you know? It's gone there, and it's limbs up, it's going to show off, its feet have smashed up. And it's just a complete change of its whole environment. I think it's a lot to do with the pH level in the soil. So we'll get back on track again. There's obviously injury, trauma. It's got a concussion treading on itself, causes the cracks, poor horn quality, abscess burst, or sight, obviously at the coronet, causes the majority of horizontal cracks, unless it's trauma, CD toe, laminating, the laminal wedge, they're always cracking up. And probably one that I didn't really want to put down the last two, but I've been guilty of it, and I'm sure everyone else has, but over-large nails, fine nailing, or inappropriate shoeing style or cycle. And that's when I say you shoe a hunter, pencil heels on here, one shoe in a month, and it probably goes 6 weeks. Shoe grows over, the load's sinking down, the foot's got to go out over it. You know, I do a couple of Welsh cobs, they have levels on, and if they get shot at the right period, they're great. As soon as they go over that level and they start, it's got a crack. The horn tube goes out, designed for that. So I'm definitely guilty of that. Not that I tell the customer, but I'm definitely guilty. So treatment's pretty simple, really. It's all about assessing the cause and then put it right. So, like I said, I've tried all over my short shoeing period. I've tried loads of different, and when I worked for Hugh, we were always doing different things. French nailing, stables, burning, scoring, crack plates, gluing them on, screwing them on. I'll show you the method that I tend to use now, if I ever have to. And I think everyone has their own method of doing it, and that's important. If you've got a method that works for you, then that's great. The method I'll show you, and what we're going to do with the horse, is the method that I find works for me. And that's what it's about, is knowing your method, really. It's paramount that you know, a lot of cracks are medial lateral balance. So, promote level flat foot fall, you've got to see it walk up. Sometimes if I've got a really deformed foot, I'll take the shoes off and then walk it up. I think some horses, when they're landing, they'll use parts of the shoe as a pivot point, especially when it's probably got rotation for the knee, it'll land on the outside of your shoe, a sharp outside, it'll pivot down. I think you can walk them up with the shoes on, trim them and walk them up without, and see where you're going with that. And correct them where possible. Foot with imbalances, whether you've got to do it with the shoe or with the foot. Sometimes you can't do it with the foot, and you can only do what you can in one shoeing, you know, you can't fix it. This also come in today, and the lad that's been doing that's done a grand job of it. It's come on a long way, and it might take 2 years to fix a crack, because for every little bit you get it grown out, it comes up a little bit. So the only time I tend to use any type of burning or a scoring line is, I might score the top of a crack, The only reason is I don't think it does anything, but it lets me know the position of the crab last time I shot it. And that's all. But I have burned it, like I say, but I think if you're going to burn a crab to stop it, I have a little question mark, a little upside down smiley face. And I used to think, oh, we did that, and it would just diverse off, but it doesn't tend to, it tends to go straight through it. And I think if you put a lot of lines down the feet, I think you're just weakening the structure that you're trying to get stronger, and it doesn't look nice either, you know? So that's how medial lateral out, anterior posterior barge, you know, you might have to look at putting a bar shoe on, which we'll get to in a minute. So shoeing to reduce hoof capture movement, which is, you know, a lot of it is movement of the hoof capture, so you've got to stop that, especially with these deep and complicated cracks, you've got to stop them. You know, if they've gone up through the coronet, then you've got to stop that movement and you've got to stop that pinching of the sensitive lamellae. So a lot of the way I'd do it is I'd either shoe it, I'd put some big clips on, depending on the position, like your toe quarters, your heel quarters, further back, depends on where I wanted to stop that movement. Big strong clips, and probably lay them up the side of the wall, don't burn them in. And a lot of the time I'd use a bar shoe, and I've put there with a choice of shapes in the bar, depending on the hoof capture or heel shape, because you can't put every horse into the same box. So, you know, some of these upright, long, narrow, contracted feet, good heel foundation. They're fine with egg bars, I use egg bars as well, but a lot of these big old flat feet, which is more what's going to get your cracks, your low, weak heels, your toes slung forward. Then I think straight bars over there on them, or even a full support shoe, a frog support may be needed, or a half bar if you've got a quarter crack and you want to float it. So I think the important thing about a bar shoe is I've put there, it centralises the heel landing, which I'm a big believer that it does, and especially these horses we were talking about that are landing outside first and flipping down. I think with a bar shoe on there, it does make them land parallel in the heel, but it can tend to make them land over parallel and then have a flipping action. And that's all to do with your biomechanics and your position of your bar, your length and your centre of your articulation, and even in front and behind of that, to do with all that, of how it lands. So stabilising and mobilising the hoof crack in the proximity of the crack, simply distally, like we said, big strong clip. And I've done it before where you get the superficial crack and you put your clips on and it holds the bottom together, and you put a staple at the top or a plate on, and the crack just stays exactly in the middle. And I've messed about with them for years, and the crack stays exactly in the middle. And then nowadays, I just leave completely alone, because it's not a problem. When you pick up the bottom of the foot, it's not split through the wall, it's nowhere near your white line, you can't see it. So it's just a superficial crack. How it's there when it's not from the top where it goes from, I don't know. I'm not a scientist, but I just leave it well alone now. It's paramount, as I said, you've got to remove any dishes and flares and dress the foot back to a strong, optimal, symmetrical hoof capsule. As much as symmetry can be gained, depending on the foot. You want to straight move past an axis. And I've put there debriding through loose horn and debris at the depth of the crack, removing necrotic material. You don't want it to get infected. Obviously, if you start doing anything invasive, then you know you've got to be doing that with a vet. Floating the crack, I think that's what I do with all my grass ones, anything where I have shoes on, is I'll float the bottom of the crack, I'll V it off, take the weight bearing off it. Keep them cleaning it. They've got to clean it, because I think a lot of the problem is you clean out the hole and you think that's it, and you go away. But that bit you've done is the third bit, and they need to keep treating that and keep it clean for the next 6 weeks or 4 weeks or whatever often you're going to do it. And a lot of them don't. And I think a lot of them, the muck gets packed in there, and the downward pressure, the upward pressure of the muck, and then that just causes the crack even further. So I've started now, I clean them out, but they've got to treat it. Whereas for a while, I didn't clean them out because I thought, well, they just let them pack in and it gets worse. But the one I've been doing it with, it's a lot better to clean it out. And I've just put at the bottom of there, tuned with a wide flat section, which we all say, oh, it's feet are flat, or they're dropped and they're all flat out, so yeah, let's put a wide section in it, give as much width on it as we can. You know, we all love wide sections. And I must admit, especially with Shelly feet, which is where you've got your Shelly wall, which are formed of small stretch fractures due to nailing, I think them feet are actually better with a narrower section on, because what it does is it makes the foot actually stand up on this smaller perimeter, it makes the wall stand up on it. Whereas with your big old wide flat sections, I think the horse is always descending, and I think it descends onto it, and sometimes it'll go flatter and wider. But that's just my theory on that. So I said I'd talk about my choice of a crack repair using. I use a filler and I screw an aluminium plate on it. This is an old picture from when I did the AW. There's a lot of screws in that. I think it's, you know, over the top. I think if you have two buttons either side, that's fine. One thing I wouldn't do with that is there's three there, so there's six very close together, there's four there very close together. The problem when you put so many close together is you could cause tiny cracks from screw to screw. So I think two, for the ones I've done, it's been sufficient. The reason I like this method is, this is obviously a water crack repair, is it's what I'll do on this horse today, is I put a bit of filler. Any type's better with either Airbox or GMA. You want a slow curing filler. You're super fast, so your Equifane is a fast curing acrylic. I use a slower one, which takes a lot longer. Its final cure time is probably 12 hours. Because a big thing with these cracks is, where do you fix it? Do you fix it when obviously the toe crack closes under the load and the quarter crack opens under the load? So do you fix it shut? Do you fix it open? So I prefer to put a layer of filler on, and I glue the paint onto the filler, and I screw through the filler into the wall, because the final cure time is about 12 hours, so that it's curing as the horse is weight bearing, not weight bearing. So there's no risk of you pinching the foot there. The other good thing about putting filler on is obviously when you screw into these feet, you've got to look at your wall. The horse I've just seen outside there hasn't got a lot of wall on it, very small feet. So a lot of your screws these days, you know, you can't just willy-nilly whack it in there. So your filler, you can gauge your wall and your filler, and you can put a bigger screw in there, because it's going through your filler, and it's only going into the wall a little bit, but it's a bigger screw, so it's holding it. Sometimes with complicated cracks, obviously you've got your bleeding, there's the gruesome infection. It's great if you can opt up it or polish it and clean it all up, and you can come and you can debride your edges and clean out a channel. Sometimes you can't do that, so you might have to put a drain in. So you can put a straw down the back, and you put a straw down the back, put some Vaseline on your straw, put your filler over, glue your plate on, screw it. Last thing you do is the filler doesn't stick to any grease. You've got to degrease everything. So your straw pulls out and you've got to drain down the back then. You notice I haven't said anything about doing the edges of cracks. I've got some pictures in a minute, so we'll go through them. I think if the crack is starting to, especially on a false quarter, if the crack is starting to overlap and you've got that chapping effect, I think you've got to take the edges off to stop that. But it's never going to knit together. It's only going to grow out from the top, but it'll never re knit. So a lot of cracks, I don't tend to get too carried away. But I think if you can open it up and debride it and let the air at it, which is what the last one with this, with one of these cracks, which is great. And he hasn't done that long ago, so I wouldn't filler it yet, because I'm not keen on fillering, because I think if you haven't just put it quite clean behind it, it can abscess up behind the filler, and I think you open a can of worms. I think it's better to let the air at it and let it treat it. But obviously, cosmetically for the owner, they like it if you filler it and they think the cracks have gone away. But I know some people have probably done it, and they've probably done the jigsaw puzzle with the Andrew pointing. I must admit, I haven't tried that. I tend to just stick to this method because I've had success with it in the past. And when I was talking about a horse that I did a a long time ago, and I should have photos of it. I was doing a road working, I think you call it a racing pony, I think the word is, where they're racing on the road, but they shut the road, it's illegal, I think, but they race them, and I was shooting this one, and it's inside this front foot, it had loads of little transverse horizontal cracks all the way down. And I said, how's it doing that then? Oh, I don't know. And it was knocking into itself, it was crossfiring. And I thought, oh, that's not great. So I must admit, I don't need to qualify. I just kept shooting it, saying, toe tips behind so it could push off and no one shoots in front. And then one of these cracks split. It went too long between shooting, his foot overgrew, it split, it's very up for his coronet. They couldn't work it because every time you tried it out, it started bleeding. So what do we do? So I put a pair of plain stamp bar shoes on it, and I crack plated it like that with the filler, put the crack plate on. But the most important thing is I figured out the cause of that crack, which was nothing to do with the front foot, it was the hind foot that was crossfiring into it. So I changed it behind, shot it with a square and toe, dubbed its toe off, the side clips, put a trailer on it, and that altered that. So there's no good fixing the crack in front if you haven't fixed the problem. And that sorted that out, and it stopped it, it was no longer bleeding, and it did actually grow out. And that was the one that I said, I wish I'd have taken photos of it. So that's basically my theory on it. I'll show you some pictures, and I've just got some notes here, so I'll just look at them. Like the various glue on patches, and you know, you could think, well, why screw it? You know, you can just, you buy up the stuff thing, and you get the glue, and you stick it on. Great. But the problem is it, you know, you've got to think of the environment and the horse's natural environment that it's in, and they're all right gluing them on. But I don't have a lot of confidence in these glues and these acrylics, unless they're in completely clinical conditions, you know, they're absolutely clean. So basically I started this 4 weeks ago when I looked at the picture of Jill's crack, and so in the last 4 weeks I've tried to compile some pictures, and I thought, well, I don't have any horses with cracks. I was quite, I thought, well, I don't have any. But then actually you start looking at horses, and nearly every single horse you shoot has some type of crack or blemish on it, whether it's a small little fracture, horizontal crack, and especially that this is a hunter just come in. So it come in, what's the day of that? 20th of last month. And the feet are shot. They haven't been trimmed all summer. They just chuck them out and you just go get on and work with it. So there's little stress fractures, but nothing, you know, I'll be too excited about it. Just trim it up and nail the shoe on. Same as a horizontal crack on the front, should be an old tread. It's not causing any problem at the moment. All I do is I just take my grasp and score each side of it, just to tidy up the edges. Obviously, because it has blood from the coronet, that bit from there to there will be loose. I wouldn't nail it to that, I'd get above it. If it was a little bit higher there, I wouldn't bother me nailing into it. It's not going to cause a problem at the moment, it's on the outside of the front foot, so which is great. So it's just going to grow out, and probably next time it gets shot, it will probably come off and take care of itself like most of them do. This is a different horse. It's got two parallel sand cracks there, but not all the way through the coronet. It's also got an old injury there, a horizontal crack. I must admit, I can't remember if this started, it must have started obviously after this or just before it. I think it's all evolved. And basically with that is just put the side clips on, tighten it up. You know, I ain't going to start plating that or anything. I'll just keep an eye on it and see how it goes. And I shot it the other day. I shot it the 10th, so that'd be Thursday. So it is a little bit better. I've just took the edges off the bottom. It's still a slight little dish in the side of your foot. You know, the clip's more set onto the side and cut too far in. I think you get more support when they're laying on the side. Obviously, on your inside, you don't want them out too much because they're going to catch with them. But like I was saying earlier, with any sort of shoe, you can't do it all in one go, so it's a it's a continuation, and it's alright me coming in and saying, well, you do that, and all your cracks will be fine. But cracks change, and horses change, and every time you've got to reassess it and decide. And I might decide in 2 more shillings that I'm not happy with that, and I might try and put some type of support on it, but at the moment, they're not causing a problem. The owner knows it's there, she's not concerned, the horse is sound, it's working, so I don't get too excited about it. That's just a picture of just what we're talking about, these shelly feet. That's not fine nailed, but with the environment going out and coming in, and the wood drying out, we all get it, especially between June and end of last month. You know, the feet are always cracking up, and it's one of those things. And the problem is when I did the talk about keeping feet strong, is if the owner's doing everything they can, they're treating it, the diet's right, then our job's easy. Everything seems to be on us, we have to just sort it out, you know. They'll keep enough money for shoeing, but when it comes to feed supplements and all that, and they think I work for poor feed, so they think I should give it for free. So, there's just another one. I shot that on yesterday, actually. So I was just putting it together last night. That, it lost the shoe, it broken all its foot off the bottom, it all splayed out. So all I tend to do now is I just underline it. And that's all I tend to do now, is I'll underline it. Great way to do it is underline it and stop it going any further. I didn't use to, I used to just leave it. But you've got that little bit that, so when you clench it up, there's a little, it's just a lip that's folding up. And that's got to come off, it's loose anyway, so it's got to come off. And then the monk can't get up behind it. I think, you know, debriding it and cleaning it is important. This is also spoke about earlier, it's a front foot on home, this a big cob. You can see you've got quite a tight toe shape on him. So some big clips on. And he's had these two cracks. They only go to there, they're not at the top, they're not at the bottom. There's no sign of that's the one I was talking about. He's always had them for years. I had a very slick staple, so I got a staple here, and I got a staple here, and a staple here. And then they'd go down and move the staples up again. Same with the crack repair, you keep moving it up. So your foot ends up, instead of being like that, where it's got no blemishes on it, it's got a hole here and a line, and a hole there, and a line, a hole there, yeah, all the way up here. And we did it for about a year and a half, 18 months, and it never improved. It actually got worse because she was going to shows and it had loads of lines all over its feet. So we decided that it was only, it's not detrimental to it, it's not causing a problem. So I just leave it well alone. That's a closer view of it. You see the one on the left. It's hardly significant really, it's just like a split in the horn tubules. One on the right, slightly more, but as I said, never caused a problem, so I just leave one alone. There's the other front foot. Same with this horse, Watty. I've probably shot this for 4 or 5 years, and when it came, it had this crack. It was come up on it. The vet pointed it out, like they do when they vet them. And it's actually got a slight little dip in its coronet, where its coronet slightly sunk. And I think once they get that sinkage in the coronet, it's either been an injury or trauma or direct blow. It's actually top eyed, so that's on the outside, so very unlikely it stood on itself, could have stood on itself if it stood, could have done that. But I think once they get this sinkage in the coronet, I think it's pretty chronic. There is the fact that it's altered the tube, like the pillar arrangement, where it goes from the coronet, and that's when you get your irregular pattern of growth. And that's been like that for 4 years. It never been a problem. It has actually started opening up a little bit at the bottom as it went too long between shoeing, and that's it really. It's just a zoom up of it, and you can see there's a slight dip in there. I think then, when they have that dip, there's nothing you can do about it. Simple as that, I leave it alone. And that's it shut up, it's got the clips on, and it's shut up, and it's actually dressed up a bit more, and it's not a problem. So it's just a picture of a little pony, Sammy, that does endurance. That's his outside of his left front. I'd class that as a false quarter, but it's not false, it's still in capping intact. as long as it's shod regular, it's just shod in an oatmeal shoe. Little bit of width, just endurance, so it can't have too much. It's got the classic sand crack down the middle, and there's a slight one on the side. That's got a dip in its coronet where it's had a lesion. And as long as that's shod regular, and any little flare here is taken off, and it's got a little stand on, that's never a problem. But if it did go too long and it was neglected, then I'm sure this fit would come false, and it would probably need more attention at half-hour, I was saying, but at the moment, it's fine. There's another view of it. This hunter just come in. It's actually the back feet of the one that was on the front. So the old horse has had a bad old summer. And that to me is just a grass crack with its quarter, and it's shod, it's on the inside, so you can't give it too much. It hasn't been clenched, so there's a bit more left to come off yet. That'll sort out, it'll just sort itself out with the support of the shoeing and the base for the shoeing with the shoe, it'll sort itself out. That's Byron, and also a classic toe crack really, bit of seedy toe as well. Got side clips on it, big old footed, half shire red. Run the toes back for venting, the vet always says toes too long, so they keep coming back. But when you take all the toe off, which is the strongest part, bam, a crack, and then they get the seedy toe in there, so I just float in the bottom. I haven't gone too mad with rooting the sides up, but a lot of the problems with this is they've got to treat it and they've got to look after it. And I don't think they even ride it. But I've got the big clips on the side there. You can see the size of the clip there from the side view. Drawing it together. Just about a straight hoof wall, but it's slightly what I would call dorsal rounded. Which is, when I say dorsal rounded, it's something I do quite often really, is I only dress the bottom half of the foot and leave the strength in the bottom. Right where your laminate, all bones with your pedal bone, and they leave the strength there instead of wiping them right back. I think that's a big thing, is you go to Austin, it's got a crack and you straighten them all right off. And the next time you go to it, I remember saying last time, its toe's dipped and it's got a dip in the toe. And that's because the structure's gone so weak. But you think, gosh, just grow that little bit at the bottom again. So you get it on the stand and you knock that off and you think, that's good. And shoe it up and you go back next time and it's grown that little bit. And I don't think it's grown that little bit, it's just sunken and gone forward. And I would say like it's like obviously a piece of angle iron or anything that could have been in a bridge, or you know, that's what you want to be trying to form in to keep it strong. So I prefer that sort of shape to that dead straight. But obviously I do a lot of competitions, you've got to have a straight hoof wall. But it depends on the judges, you know. What I tend to do in a competition, I do exactly what I do every day, just the same. I don't do anything different, apart from I might get sand in the mop and sand around a bit. But good auction is good auction at the end of the day. So that's just one. It was just, this one I did a shunt to the heel, which has nothing to do with what we're doing, but it was just to show about flow to the heel. And how I'd go about that if we had a quarter crack. So that's just a half out that fitted with the crack would be on that inside which the half bar comes up. And how I did it is I just fit the shoe like normal. Early on, you know, your shoe is flat, everything's done. And then just before I nail it on, I'd get my knife on the rasp and I'd take your quarter out. I wouldn't do that before, but get everything on a flat plane and then do it. And you can see it's got a shunted heel there. And that fixed that problem, and it was an ongoing problem actually. It's later on this afternoon, so it should know it. And that's it from the medial view with the heel floating. So that's what I'd do if we had a real bad crack down the areas, I'd float that off, take the weight bearing off it, and then stabilise it from that. So, and this is just saying, this is what I would call a blemish really, or a big figure on the side. And it's just saying, just almost ideally had its foot stuck in a gate, and it come back from the worm, and this is exactly as it come back, which is really nice to send it back like that. That was in 2007. February 2007. So, and the reason I put this up here is because I think a lot of things with all horses is trial and error. And whenever I go to the vets, I deal with one of the vets, go on to little things at a time, and you might often think, and it's a living object, you might not like that, maybe too much this to it, maybe too much growth for it, so you'd be on to it, and I would try all the little things at a time. But with this horse, it's retired, you know, it's finished. It was just to keep it comfy in the field really, and the first time I did it, I trimmed this right back, and I actually bled the top of it, and I dressed it right back, and I thought, yeah, get it off, and next time I come, it had grown down a bit, and I looked at it, and I actually went a couple of weeks later, looked at it, and it was a little bit sore for having it dressed back, so I thought, well, I'll try leaving it like that, you know, it looks horrible, but if the horse is comfy, great, so I left it like that for a bit, and then it trod on it and ripped the whole thing off. So then I redid it, and what I do now is I leave the top and I dress the bottom back, because as this horse has developed in the last couple of years, it's actually developed a horizontal crack underneath that, because it's like that's grown from further up and it was grown over the coronet and it kept in abscesses. So I dress it now and square it off a bit. That's the view of it when it come back. So you can see how there's a tiny crack up there, so this bit here is actually loose, so it wanted to come off. That's it from the saddle, we're stuck in a gate, and that's it, I whacked it all off. I dressed it all back, and that's still from the original injury, it's just floated anyway. And I went back to it this week, and like I said earlier, the feet go too long, it goes too long between trimming and owners can, they don't see that little bit hooking over there, because this was all dressed back square every time. They don't see that it's developed a tall grass crack, which always tend to be in conjunction with your attachment of the extensive process. The tall crack is very common with the leverage and the longer foot. But owners don't see these, they don't ring you up and say, oh, these little toppers just developed a little crack. They don't even notice, you know, that's where it lives in the field. So she didn't notice. I went this week and it's gone too long, it's got a stack of foot on. This is too long, so you've got to start all over, and that's how our show is really. You know, if it was easy and it was a block of wood and you just did it once and that was it, it would be great, but it's not, and things change and you've just got to keep adapting to what you've got. And that was it after I trimmed it off, and that's how I tend to trim it now, is I'll leave that bit there and I dress up with the side of the rasp and take it right back up so that we can free this bit because it was abscessing under there. And the toe crack has two majors up and off and it's floated. And a lot of people, you know, they could dig that out a lot more. But that for the first time for me is sufficient. I'll be back to have a look at it. You know, I'm better now than I used to. 8 years ago I'd have let the customer dictate to me when it needed doing. Now I try to say to them, look, you know, if you want to get it right, you've got to get it done a little bit more often. But obviously, we're all in the same world here with finance and doing horses. But the way I always took a look at it is if the vet come out and looked at it when it was like that before, which if I let it go 9 weeks again, that's what it's going to look like. The vet comes out and the vet says, what idiot trims this, you know? They don't turn around and say to the vet, oh, I had it for 9 weeks. Yeah, the vet thinks he did that last week. So, you know, they need educating a little bit, which is the hardest bit of it. And that's the side view. It's got a lot of scar tissue just there. Not that you can do about that. If you walk straight, it's back straight. So that's just scar tissue from the irregular horn growth. And there's the bottom feed off. And that's about all I do with cracks, really. So you'll probably expect a bit more than that, but I keep it quite simple. So I think we'll have a coffee break and we're going to bring the horse in. I've had a little look at it. Hasn't got a lot of foot on it. It's got open heel shoes on it. I think for the cracks I'm going to put a bar shoe on it. Ideally, if we've got some Pegasus, I'll clip them up and we'll put them on. If not, we've got a forge for some steel, we'll make a pair for it. And then this afternoon, I'm going to do on just bar shoe making, concave bar shoe making, the egg you straighten your heart, like I do every day of the week. And I'll probably shoe 5 horses a week in bar shoes. I always make them, and I'll go through that this afternoon. It's not all shoe making, a bit of fabrication as well. keeping it simple. So that's it really.